have some pretty great news for everyone here. I did my first public skipping. First public skipping. That's right, it happened yesterday. I was doing a workout. There's a trail. I decided I'm going to skip down the trail. And there was nobody there. I was just doing the skipping. Wow, it was fabulous. Finally, there was this Uber yoga girl there by the side, leaning up against some concrete block or something. But she was so immersed in her smartphone, she wasn't really paying attention. I just skipped right on by her. Just skipped on by. I finally came to the end of the trail, and there's two young men there. And I came skipping up to them, kind of at the end of the trail. And they kind of looked at me like, what, like they just seen, you know, Bigfoot or something. It's like, huh? Skipping? So it was awesome. First public skipping. I kind of felt like my first something, you know. It's like, wow. Like some monumental barrier had been passed. Maybe we're getting ready to skip out on this world, right? Or skip out on something, right? Absolutely. It's something like that. I said, I hope there's not too many people around it, because it gets self-conscious. But no, there's nobody. I just skip it along. Now, here's a very good tip now from someone who's actually done this. Is that don't do it on asphalt, kind of coarse asphalt trails, because the traction is so severe when you're trying to skip, it really heats up the soles of your feet severely. I thought I would separate from my feet. It was so bad. Do it on like dirt trails or sort of smooth concrete trails. It slides better. It doesn't grab it, but the harsh asphalt, it's too much traction, and it kind of really heats up your feet. Boy, my feet were heated up. But the day was hot anyway. I mean, it was 98 here. I was out in the hot sun working out. But it's like breaking a barrier, a taboo. It's skipping along. I was just out there skipping along down a trail. I was like, am I really doing this? Who does that? Like kids, you know, like 5-year-olds, they might skip for a little while. But I skipped the entire trail. I must have been maybe half a mile or so. It was significant. I thought, I can't do this. It's too far. No, I was able to do it. This is really astonishing. But my legs and body today, I feel okay today. But yesterday I could really feel it. But just be able to skip for a long distance and not, you know, today I feel pretty good. Wow. It's like just astonishing. And we might think, what does this have to do with anything? Well, it may have a lot to do with everything. It's the ability to shift gears. You know, power shift, here we go. Yeah. Power shift, here we go. Gotta be cool. Power shift, here we go. Shut down. It is the ability to go into a different mode of being, so to speak. When you're skipping, you feel in a different mode of beingness. It's changes just your whole psyche. It's really amazing. We don't realize, like when we're walking, it's a certain thing, and when we're jogging, it's a different psyche. We feel kind of jogging along. We kind of feel different, right? Well, skipping really puts you in a different frame of mind. You could just try it. Skip around your driveway. You know, just like maybe a couple hops, and just feel like, oh, can I do this? And when you do it, you'll say, oh my gosh, I can do this. Movement is important in terms of how we move. It's very important. So this was just a revelation. Pulled it off. Dan did a video on Sri Sri Nandamayaman, the novice of Dhaka, which I've been meaning to do for years and years, and just couldn't do it. I finally pulled it off. It took me all day. A lot of work. But it's a beautiful video. So that was really great. Now, welcome to this The satsang. Take satsang. Don't take drugs. Take satsang. See, don't take drugs. Take satsang. Don't take drugs. Take satsang. It's the medicine. It's the medicine. Now, this skipping thing. Let us focus on what's really going on in this world. I don't even know if I can say it. But there's trouble with the Chinese, okay, the red Chinese. There's trouble with the red Chinese, to say the very least. I am getting so much spontaneous feedback here in the Silicon Valley from people. Everybody's talking about it. There's so many Chinese. It's between 60 and 70% of all real estate transactions are now being, the mainland Chinese are buying the property here. 60 to 70%. They're flooding into the Silicon Valley. And everybody's mentioning, like, what, you know, because they stand out by the way they drive, the way they act is extraordinary. They don't play by our rules at all. They play by their own rules. And they people saying in a store, you have a line of people, and they just walk to the front of the line and pretend that you don't exist. And then they spend all this time. The people are like, well, what are you doing? They drive like you don't exist. They make their own rules up as far as driving goes. But it's not just driving. It's in stores, too. I've had numerous examples of this myself where we'd be waiting to be waited on. And the Chinese will come in, and they'll just walk right past you, right up to the clerk, and expect to be waited on like you don't exist. They can't recognize a line. I mean, what is the mindset of someone who doesn't, not able to understand what other people are about? Very, very, very peculiar. And a friend of mine just told me his girlfriend's father is mainland Chinese, and he said when they're driving, he doesn't obey the rules, and they say, what are you doing? He says, it's not, hey, it says it's my rules. I make the rules. It's like, so we're starting to get the psychological profile of what's going on here. They expect other people to obey their rules. They don't assimilate. Now the Hispanics and people from other countries come here, they assimilate. Okay, the Hispanics are wonderful in many ways. I know there's too many, you know, it's flooding everything. Okay, that's an issue, but they get it. They get it. You know, very polite, very respectful, understanding, you know, just basic common sense of golden rule. You know, they treat others they're very, very, they're just really, really have great common sense and basic human respect with one another. It's really good. And most people here have that. Not the mainland Chinese at all. They stand out like a sore thumb. Now, it's very, very interesting, I find it, that the gurus, the great Dharma kings that I have now, that I'm now affiliated with, for one, Longchenpa, who he certainly understands politics, having narrowly escaped an assassination attempt and having to flee Tibet for Bhutan. That was because of a warlord there misunderstood his activity. But he, you know, they had to, they certainly understand this. But Jamyen Khyentse Choki Lodro, who I'm really paired up with now, Longchenpa paired me up with him, because we're simpatico. There's just a feeling like, hard to describe, but you just, if like a friend, like a brother, you know, just someone that you just feel at ease with. Well, he, first of all, had to flee Eastern Tibet, Kham, for Central, and then in Central, he had to flee Tibet to India in 1959. I believe it was the 50, or it could have been a little, I think it was that, but, and he had to slip through the dragnet that they had there. He was Most certainly on their list to be apprehended, being the most famous Tibetan in eastern Tibet and escaped there now in central Tibet. Of course they wanted to apprehend him. And he disguised himself as just a lowly monk and was able to go through the checkpoints. So he was able to escape the Red Chinese. The Cultural Revolution of that time. And then he actually dropped the body in that year of 1959. He went to Varanasi in 19, I think it was 1956, for the 2500 year Jayanti, which is a celebration of Buddha's birth, his enlightenment, and his parinirvana, May 24th, 1956, which was just a few months before I was born, actually. So I was born in the 2500th jubilee year of Buddha's birth, nirvana, and parinirvana. And when he was in Varanasi, I checked, and Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma also was staying in Varanasi at that time. Very possible they could have crossed paths. Certainly been aware of each other at that time. Really, in the same place right there, 1956, which is 60 years ago. Now, my information and intuition is that geopolitics is going to heat up, and the Chinese are at the center of it, and they want the rest of the world to play by their rules, very plain and simple. Very, 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 it's amazing. It just, so the world is about to, events are about to change and change and change and change. They'd certainly, the hottest topic now, you could be talking about Jesus Christ returning and people would say, oh, really, really? Okay, gun control, gun control, gun control, gun control. I'm very much anti-gun control. Okay, very much so. This is one of the bedrocks of the United States of America. Understanding throughout history, the founders made it very important that the citizens had a right to bear arms. Why? To prevent despotism from taking place. And also to have a citizen militia to prevent other countries from taking over. In other words, or preventing tyrants from making alliances with other places and being usurped in that way, where the citizens have no recourse whatsoever. And this is the problem, is I'll tell you this, that there's nothing that China wants more and that is pushing harder for than the gun control in the United States. They would absolutely love for the citizenry of the United States to be disarmed because they absolutely have their eyes on the United States as far as taking it over. They have a 100-year plan for taking over the United States. They have these 100-year plans. It's been 70 years. They've been subverting the United States for 70 years, actually. And they literally map out a 100-year plan. They set their targets on something, and they gradually subvert it, termite it, break the moral fiber down, all this stuff. But the only what's standing in their way is that the citizens are armed to the teeth. Well, we've already have now taken the ammunition away from people, which is why people have been stockpiling it. See, Americans are not dumb. They're the smartest people in the world, actually. Because being raised in a democracy which was based on wisdom, stretching back thousands of years of this is what happens in the world. And we need to take preventive measures to prevent it from happening. Americans have this feeling of freedom, and when someone's trying to take their freedom away, they can very easily feel it. Where the rest of the world, they don't notice it so much because they're used to being in chains. And so what does it matter if you put some more chains on them? They just, don't really pay attention. But if you're used to being free, when someone tries to put some chains on you, you say, "Hey, what are you doing?" So I'm not a gun owner. I never owned guns, and of course they're dangerous for sure, but responsible gun ownership. And the fact is, it's the crazies will always be able to get guns. When they say when guns are outlawed, only outlaws will have guns, which is very true. And if someone is crazy, they will find a way, okay, and they will carry out something crazy. And that the truth is, many of these incidents that happened, if public had a concealed carry, they're able to carry, these would have been stopped by citizens. But a lot of the stuff, like the Fort Hood thing, on a military base, no mil thanks to, well, who was it, Clinton or something, no military personnel are allowed to carry weapons on a military base. And so here's this lunatic that's able to bring in a gun and just start shooting or executing everybody, and nobody has a gun to stop it. It's crazy. It's so stupid. If people were allowed concealed carry, responsible citizens, these type of situations would not be arising as much as they are. And yes, but if you disarm, you are inviting despotism. You are inviting it. And the Chinese most certainly will take advantage of that. They're extreme opportunists. They don't respect your laws and your rules and your way of life at all, as they showed in Tibet. They show no respect whatsoever for the Tibetan culture. They show no respect for religious traditions whatsoever. It's just all about profit and dominance for them. And just taking over, taking over, taking over, taking over, like army ants. Unfortunately, this is their modern history. Feeling that they're an ancient peoples, they have the right to rule this planet. Well, guess what? A lot of people come from a Judeo-Christian tradition, which is 6,000 years old, approximately. It goes way back, way, way back. Okay, so we don't feel that just because someone's an ancient culture. Well, great. So the Indian Vedic culture is ancient, also the Persian culture is ancient, also. There's a lot of ancient cultures around. Judeo-Christian is one of them. So we don't, we feel, hey, everybody, play by the rules here. You don't just take over and dominate. And we happen to like freedom. We happen to like freedom. Once you get a taste of freedom, you're not going to give it up. So this massive push by these morons, I call liberals, they're communist sympathizers and really communist agents. They're doing the work of the communists for them, which is what the communists, they're very skillful at that, propagandizing generations so that they end up subverting the country and preparing it to be taken over for them, actually. They're very, very smart, clever people. Not bad people. I mean, I could interact with them. I did yesterday, a Chinese and his little daughter. And when you treat him, treat him with kindness and respect, they're very nice, they're very loyal. But they have this issue, a very bad issue here, of taking over and bullying other cultures. Just happens to be a peculiarity. It's weird. Somebody experienced happened on, I think it was Friday, a couple of days ago. Some people came to where I was, Chinese, and they look at you like, "Who are you? Like, you're some kind of weird alien or something." I said, "What are you talking? This is the United States of America. What do you mean, who am I?" Looking at us, the way they look at us, like, "What are you doing here? This is, this is my place. What are you doing here?" No, it's not your place. It's the place of people who love freedoms. Okay, Americans means people who love freedom. It's our place. Okay, it's our place. You don't like freedom? Go back home. You don't want to play by the rules of freedom? Go back home. You don't belong here. But everybody says, "Oh, you political correctness. You can't say that." What do you mean we can't say that? we're at a point we'll be arrested if we say that. I mean, whose rules are we playing by in America right now is the question. So it's very, very telling that these Tibetan masters are on the case big time. They're super aware of certainly they know the Chinese extremely well. Who knows them better? Who knows how they operate better than the Tibetans? So the Tibetans are acting like there's a crisis coming. Really, very much so. So, I mean, there's a crisis coming. So, the Chinese are involved in that crisis. You can bet your bottom dollar on that. They're not the only ones. They may be patsies, as I have said. Like Oswald was a patsy in the JFK assassination. They may be being used by what I call the reptilians. For just like the liberals are being used to subvert this country, the Chinese are using them to subvert this country, the reptilians are using the Chinese to subvert this world. And the reptilians realized that the Tibetans were an extreme obstacle to them coming into this world because of the spiritual greatness and commitment of their culture. Padmasambhava, the whole idea is he drove out these demons from Tibet, these various dimensional entities, and they have the capacity to purify and prevent these nasty entities from gaining too much influence in their area. And if the Tibetan the spiritual technology of the Tibetans spreads throughout the world, this would block the reptilians from taking over this planet. So they used the Chinese to try to destroy Tibet, and they're using the Chinese right now to further subvert this world for this dominant agenda. I mean, the Chinese treat us here in Silicon Valley the way the reptilians would treat the whole world, which is we own the place. You play by our rules. It's like we own this place. And of course they're buying houses and stuff here. They think they own our freedom. Guess what? You don't own our freedom just because you own property here. Everybody has equal property rights here, and the freedoms are protected. But the reptilians, they're very, very much this dominant mentality. Now, like the Chinese, you can relate with them, and you would say, well, they're nice people, but they have this peculiarity of this very strict hierarchical type of culture and rules and regulations and orders, and you know it's a despotism. It's a despotism, very despotic, extremely fascist and despotic and harsh. And, you do what, it's like Communist China, you do what they say, they pull up the central party, you do what they tell you, what the authority tells you, you're off to a labor camp and never heard from again. It's just that simple. Their word is the law, and they decide, just boom, this is what happens, and you have to obey. Command and obey. There's no freedom. There's no freedom in their culture at all. There's no freedom of self-expression. There's no freedom. We here in America love self-expression. I certainly love self-expression. I love free speech. I love freedom of expression. That doesn't mean that if someone's really harassing you or something, you just say, hey, enough of that. Okay, we're not stupid about it. But we love freedom. Freedom. We love freedom here. So we're freedom-loving people here. We don't like anyone telling us what to do. Within a pragmatic framework, we understand that. But a lot of the rest of the world doesn't understand that at all. They don't love freedom. They don't trust themselves. See, we trust ourselves here. I had a conversation with some business owners, and they say, my God, it's just unbelievable what's going on. And nobody has any self-reliance anymore. The younger generation, they can't find anybody to hire because they can't manage themselves, the younger people. They say it's bizarre. They need some authority, heavy-handed authority, watching their every movement. they can't, they say, look, this job, that they have to be self-reliant, manage themselves. We can't manage what they're doing all the time. They're going out on in the field doing all this stuff, and they say they're incapable of doing so. Which means these are people, the young people right now are people who want to be authoritatively controlled. Which is why they love Bernie Sanders, because of course he'll set up a socialism, which they'll tell you how to do everything. He'll completely manage your life, micromanage your life. And this owner of this business says, he says it's astonishing. He says, what does it matter to these people? And the thing is, these people cannot trust. They don't trust in themselves. For me, I said to me, look, I don't need laws. I trust myself. Okay, golden rule. I trust my own inner moral compass, for the most part. Of course, we need some rules, and which is, we understand that pragmatic, there's pragmatism. We're pragmatists, common sense, pragmatism, responsibility, hardworking, intelligent, diligent, honorable, trying to do the right thing, compassionate, Judeo-Christian compassion and love, etc. All these values, values, the right, really good human values. You don't need many laws. You trust one another. You love one another. You live by the golden rule, and you're free to express yourself. And nobody, everybody says it's fine. I mean, too. I mean, what a lovely country we used to have here. And what, how the rest of the world hates it and envies it and fears it because they don't trust themselves. They can't handle freedom. Well, that's their problem, right? Why should that be our problem? Why should those who can't handle freedom be able to impose their fear of freedom upon everyone else? And we're not going to stand for that, even if it means leaving this planet. Okay, that's, we have freedom to leave this planet, and they don't understand that. They just like the Tibetans could, they left Tibet to India, and like the Chinese, like, what the heck, you can't do that. Well, they did it. Kudos to them. You talk about self-reliance, the ability to escape and relocate to another country and then rebuild your traditions and your temples and universities and stuff. And kudos to India for allowing that to happen. I mean, that's just amazing how self-reliant the Tibetans are and able to do that. Most people would have just crumbled. Most, so, wow. And to keep their confidence and love and compassion under what happened, what took place there, it's really very extraordinary. So, we here are so used to freedom and freedom of expression. I'm so used to it that I don't even have to walk down the street. I can skip down the street. And I can come up to somebody and say something or admonish them, or, right? And without imposing any rules or laws or regulations, you have to do this. You go to a place and people, guess what? They spontaneously wait in line. Well, you here first? Yeah, you're first. And people are so polite here in terms of that way. Americans are so cool, as a people. Coolest people on the planet, really. Because there's this bottom line allowance. Sure, it's a little ragged, but we understand that too. And we have this freedom. And we can speak up and we can say stuff. And people can say stuff in public, which might irritate someone else, but they say, oh, they shrug and say, oh, I mean, he's got, they have a right to their opinion and perspective, viewpoint. And that's democracy. You can tell how fascist the liberals are, unbelievably distrusting of their own selves and freedom, because in the Silicon Valley here in the Bay Area, again, it's the heart, one of the hearts of liberalism in the country. They're extremely obsessively liberal here, and I call them Chinese agents. They really are. There's, again, still to this day, I have not seen a single Donald Trump bumper sticker or sign or any evidence that even exists. Now, he could be the worst candidate ever, but guess what? In a plurality democracy, you have the interchange of ideas and viewpoints. And people say, well, what about Trump? What do you think about him? I've been doing that. People come up to me and say that, you know, that they just wanted to talk about it. And you say, they weigh things. Democracy, you weigh it. You take the time to weigh it. Here, there's no weighing taking place at all. Nobody's weighing Trump at all. He's the devil. Are you telling me that there's nobody in the, how many people in Bay Area? 8 million or, I don't know, a lot. There's not a single person here who thinks that Donald Trump might be better than Hillary Clinton. Are you kidding me? Or that could say, well, you know, nobody. Is this a democracy or is this fascism that we're heading towards? Are liberals advocating democracy or are they advocating totalitarianism? It's totalitarianism. It's blatant. I want to put a Trump bumper sticker on just you know, to break the ice. I mean, I'm not really political. You know, I'm not. I'm spiritual, but all politics is spiritual politics, actually. And what the point is that there's no sense of freedom here. And again, someone told me if you did that, your vehicle would be vandalized. I mean, if you put a sticker on your house, they'd probably you know, burn your house down here. Seriously, the people here are fanatics. They don't realize they're fanatics. They think they're the most wonderful people in the world because they know what's best for you, and they're just thinking that benevolent. It's a benevolent dictatorship that they believe in. Well, guess what? United States of America and freedom doesn't believe in benevolent dictatorships. We don't believe in that. We prefer the raggedness of a democracy over a benevolent dictatorship because it requires us to work at our freedom. And when the more we work at our freedom, guess what? The more we spiritually gravitate to our true beingness, which is what Jesus wants for us, which is what all the Dharma kings want for us. And the more we go towards despotism and enslavement, the more we go towards materialism and belief in bodies and things that we're not spirit, that we're body, that we're flesh, that we're materiality, that we die and all this, the more we gravitate away from God, away from truth. And that's why the Chinese are so atheistic. And the more we believe in luck, which is why they're so into gambling and luck. I mean, there's all sorts of casinos here now, and then look at their advertising. It's all towards the Chinese and Asians, really. See, in America, we don't believe in luck. We believe in hard work. We believe in freedom, and the grace of freedom, and the grace of God. The grace of God is not luck. It has to do with alignment and prayer and utilizing our freedom and being attracted to our freedom. And as Jesus says, what is reality? He says, I'll tell you. He says, even he says, what is love? And he says, I'll tell you what love is, freedom. He says, freedom is actually love. That's what love actually is freedom. And he says, you are perfectly free. You're immaculately free. You're always perfectly free to experience anything you want to experience. He says, this is reality. So this world is not gravitating towards reality. The United States of America is one of the last places in the world where people are still trying to gravitate towards their freedom, towards reality. Most people are gravitating towards techno-fascism, belief they're the body. Now, cousin of mine, first cousin, I was just in a terrible auto accident, and head trauma, and put her in an induced coma, and she's breathing on her own now. So what did I do? I immediately sent prayers, and I immediately sent Jamie and Genzi Choki Lodo and Longchenpa, the whole array of Tibetan Bodhisattvas. I immediately recommended them to her. I said, you got a job to do. Go help out. It's just like, boom, like that. Because I know they can handle such situations and beautifully. They already have saved a life that I pray to help them, for them to help out. Absolutely. They understand the afterlife perfectly also. They understand everything, the whole realm of this dream realm of existence. They have mapped it out, and they're totally clear about it. It's just really extraordinary. And so I have faith and trust in them. So immediately I prayed to all the Dharma kings, to Jesus, to all the Dharma kings, and unto my Ma Ramaharshi, Longchenpa, Jamyang, Genchi Chogyi, Lodro. None to my Ma, all of them. It says, do everything you can do for my cousin. Now, everybody else they're talking about, they're all nervous when you talk about it, kind of like edgy, and they say, well, I'll think good thoughts, or I'll have a good vibe, or I'll try, you know. Nobody can say prayer. They can't say it. It doesn't exist here. You can't get the word out of their mouths. I know this maybe sounds astonishing to you, but it's absolutely true here. You don't realize the political correctness of the Bay Area, how insanely insane it is. You can't say, well, I'm going to pray for them. I'm a prayer vigil for them. No, that's backwards. That's old-fashioned, superstitious, crazy, mentally sick. You don't pray for anyone. You think good thoughts. Good thoughts. It's thoughts which are blinding us to reality. It's thoughts that are blinding us to reality. It's thinking and thoughts. It's prayer that brings us back to reality, actually. Now, I have more confidence in these Tibetan Dharma kings than I do in doctors. I mean, doctors are useful, they're mechanics, but these Tibetan Dharma kings can work on a overall 360 degree way. They can literally see everything subtly, the whole etheric body, and everything that's going on mentally with the whole situation, and adjust a karma in various ways. I mean, they're extraordinary what they can do. So I didn't hesitate. I didn't hesitate. I know that they will bring out the best outcome possible. And I know they want to help out here. They want to help. What do you think? These bodhisattvas, they dedicate their whole beingness to helping us, and they don't want us to ask them to help? Of course they want us to ask us, ask them to help in every which way. Hey, 360 degree help, bodhisattvas. They take bodhisattva vow entirely seriously, so much so that it's amazing, you know, but it works. You might think, oh, that's terrible. You know, I don't want to have to try to help people out here forever, but they're so committed to it that it's so endearing to us that it actually does help liberate us. Just extraordinary. Welcome home. Interesting. This wants to turn this way. It doesn't want to turn around. Can we get it to go like that? Okay. So we're in this amazing time. And the unexpected could happen here. Very much, just like Pearl Harbor is very unexpected, at least to most of us. Perhaps not to President Roosevelt, it wasn't. He wanted an excuse to bring the United States into the war, and the people were not really interested in the war. So that could very well have been a false flag. I mean, they probably knew about it in advance. Politics, huh? Yeah. So, you cannot trust these scoundrels, these politicians. You cannot trust them. I guarantee you this. They have their own agenda. They look at us as they don't understand freedom. They understand power and control and manipulation and propaganda and ego and they don't, you know. Politicians are politicians. They are not to be trusted at all. Even to extreme extent. This particular president is not to be trusted in any way. His background, his mentoring, his actions, the whole picture of this president, I say he would favor communist China over the United States. I don't think he loves freedom. I don't think he loves the United States. I don't think he loves freedom of expression. I don't think he loves the values of this country at all. I think he'd much prefer this country to be under communist Chinese rule than the way it is right now, as long as he is, put on the throne. So is he a collaborator? Very likely, very likely. A subversive agent of the Chinese? Very likely, actually. Very, very likely. And if we don't think this sort of thing happens, of course it happens. This is history. There's all sorts of situations where you put someone on the throne that's sympathetic to another country or something, and they end up subverting that country and delivering it into the arms of the other country. There's just geopolitics, business as usual here in this world. There's no question that he's some sort of puppet. No question, he's some sort of puppet. He's done everything possible to disarm the countries, to subvert the law, our ability to defend ourselves. Is extremely subversive person. Well, who's he subverting it to? Well, who was his mentor? Chinese communist was his mentor growing up. I can't remember his name. Frank Davis or some guy. He didn't have a father, so this father figure mentored him. And his mentor, Little Red Book of Mao, was his mentoring. He was hardcore communist growing up. So you don't think he's subversive? He is absolutely subversive, and nothing would surprise us at this point. Nothing would surprise us. I'm sure the Tibetan masters are aware of this. I'm sure Jesus is aware of this. There are very subversive elements in this world, and you can feel it. Those who love freedom are aware when they're being subverted, you know? Absolutely, they're aware of it. And it's funny because these people who don't know anything about freedom, who just all they know is despotism, they think that they're getting over on us. They really believe it. Because they don't even know what freedom is, so they say, "Well, these people can't possibly know what we're doing. We're sneaking up on them." And they're like shocked when you're aware of it. Like, how's that possible? They really don't believe that's possible. So they're just blindly going along, thinking that their plans are going to work out great for them. But when you are used to freedom, you can easily see when someone's trying to subvert it. You can easily see this. It's like a child trying to put one over on the parents, you know. The child thinks it's sneaking, getting away. The parents already know what the child's up to, you know. The child thinks, "Oh yeah, I'm really fooling him. I'm really fooling him." And parents, you know, just laugh. And it's like that. They're like children. In terms of freedom, they're like children. They don't know freedom. Freedom of expression, freedom of belief, freedom of religion, freedom to turn to God, freedom to turn to whatever spiritual source you want to. And ask for help to safeguard our freedoms. So this, I'm just expressing what everyone's aware of. This is actually happening. How treacherous will subversives be here to freedom? They might be very treacherous, actually. There might not even be an election this year, actually. Many people have seen that there won't be. And, you know, it wouldn't be surprising if there is no election. We're right at that point. All the parameters are pointing in that direction. And the young people of this country simply are too lazy to handle freedom and democracy. They want despotism, actually. Most of them. Not all. The ones that are not, they stand out and they talk to me and they say, you know, we're lazy. There's too many of our, you know, my generation, we're so freaking lazy. You know, what's the heck's the matter with them? I mean, we just want to be told what to do. We just want our gadgets and but in democracy, you got to be very self-motivated, independent and self-motivated. In terms of your valuing, and it's not easy. It's not easy at all here. It's difficult. And they just, you know, they don't want the difficulty. I mean, the difficulty of private ownership, you know, owning a house and a nuclear family. They don't want to own a house. They just want to rent an apartment, private property. All this stuff is difficult to them, and they don't want it. They just want to play video games. They grew up playing video games. I mean, we didn't grow up that way at all. We grew up working, hard work. And say, this is the chores you have today. And this weekend, you know, all weekend, these chores, tough work. You know, you got to go and do this. And scouting and, you know, vigorous hiking and trips. Self-reliance, you're taught to be strong. You're taught to be independent. Think for yourself. Stand up for yourself. All this stuff. We grew up on this. Not these generations. And the older people just look at the younger generation and said, we're screwed. I mean, we're doomed. We're doomed. They can't handle freedom. They really can't handle it. There's just so much, you know, to make as much money as possible. I mean, but there's no excuses, you know. There are a lot of good young people. There's no question. I meet a lot of them. But, in general, you might say the overall perspective is they just want big, you know, they want big Bernie to take care of them. I even told one of them that. He laughed. He said, yeah, you're right. I said, look, I mean, everybody loves Bernie because everyone's lazy. They just want government to take care of them. And he laughed. I said, yeah. He says, yeah, that's true. We're, you know, just laziness. It's 100% laziness. And yeah, they want dictatorship, benign dictatorship. To just take care of them, you know, forgive all their student loans, forgive the, you know, just they want their parents to take care of them, so to speak. Okay, that's fine, but you also lose your freedom of self-expression and all this stuff in such situations. You end up becoming idiotic, like the cartoons and the popular media. All the depictions of people in the entertainment and are humanistic, completely humanistic. The reactions, it's all super reactive, you know, burping, doing this, you know, just this idiotic animalness. Like, we're human animals. This is their belief, we're human animals. Contrast that to the gracefulness of Tibetan ceremonies and empowerments and something of this massive compassion and trust and belief in the guru and the spiritual master and in spiritual enlightenment, that we're all actually spirit and can be liberated from all suffering, from samsara, and never have to be born again. And all the contrast is just insanely brilliant contrast, extraordinary contrast, is there not, to the popular media, cartoon culture, where everything is gross. Crass and gross and animalistic. And everyone is being brainwashed in this way. This is why I stay away from this. And this is why I spend time on the internet. It's only certain things, and I found Facebook, a way to use it in the best way possible. It's really amazing. I like these certain sites, the Ramaharshi site, Facebook/Ramaharshi, and Facebook, a Hammer of Nisargadatta, I believe. Hammer, I'll have to check that up. I'll put that up too. Nisargadatta Maharaj, there's a site that keeps putting up his pictures and his advice. And then Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, I put some of these links. I'm going to keep putting these links up. Like these pages, and in your news feed, all the new pictures and advice they give show up every morning in your news feed or in real time. And so you can just always go, and you're constantly getting this tremendous grace and advice from these super great Dharma kings. Nisargadatta Maharaj is extraordinary. I don't quite put him as a Dharma king. A Dharma king is the highest, and they have this overall overview of how to help us too. Nothing escapes their attention in the big picture. Maharaj was certainly enlightened, true non-dualist. So he is certainly part of our family, of our enlightened family, our non-dual enlightened family, of our freedom. Absolutely, Nisargadatta Maharaj is a heavyweight. So is Punja Ji, for instance. All right, and there are others that are heavyweights. They don't quite rise to the level like a Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, or Jesus Christ, or Longchenpa, okay, or Ramaharshi, or Jamyang Kenzi Choki Lodro. But you know, they're right there. They're right there. They're right there. They're right there. More than worthy to listen to their advice and pay attention to what they're saying. So I just look at the Facebook feed, news feed, and I'm just getting nonstop. I mean, they do fabulous job. Those who run this Ramaharshi Facebook page are just doing a fabulous job. I mean, they just pump out 15 or more news feeds a day. I mean, it's just extraordinary what they're doing. You got to check it out. I say, how do they do this? They're working 24/7 on this, and there's new graphics coming out all the time. I know how much work it is. They're very dedicated to it. I wish I could, you know, I've tried to do that in my web Facebook page, but I don't have anybody visiting. I don't know. This is God's plan. I mean, it's just you put up these pages, and people can comment and like, and you put this feed on it, but so. I said, oh, they're doing such a great job, you know. Wonderful, 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 wonderful. Take Satsang is my Facebook page. Take Satsang is that could be a, you know, I could share a lot of stuff on that page, and that can help you also if you want to like that page. Take Satsang. Facebook, take Satsang. But whatever reason in my life, nobody tends to join or like what I do in terms of being part of it. That's okay. This is God's plan for my life. However it works out that way, I tend to be fly under the radar, which actually, there's a quote from Nisargadatta Maharaj, which this morning, which I never heard before. These teachers say things you never heard before. It helps you see in a different perspective. It's really amazingly helpful. And he said, one thing he said yesterday is attitudes indicate fear. When you collect these attitudes, when you have attitude, that's fear. And I said, wow, I never had heard that before, but it resonates like you're absolutely right. Attitudes are fear. And I realized I tend not to have attitudes these days. I don't get into attitudes at all. I've been noticing that. Less fear, you have less attitude. You just feel grace and compassion. It's just this heartfelt super confidence. There's no attitude. I'm not carrying an attitude around. I used to have attitude towards this, attitude towards this. I just don't have that anymore. It's like, wow, it's great what he's saying. So you hear these different perspectives that you've never heard before. And it's very, very helpful. Very, very helpful. To keep on hearing this. Don't pay attention to popular culture. Boycott the news and entertainment and popular culture. Take it upon yourself. This is what freedom's all about, folks. Friends. Beloved lovers of freedom. Is you have to exercise your freedom. You cannot be lazy. You cannot be lazy or you'll lose your freedom. The price of freedom is you cannot be lazy. You must be industrious to use your freedom and grow in freedom. You cannot stagnate in it. So you have to be industrious. You have to find a way to boycott the subversion of freedom in the world. And don't allow your attention to be upon that. And put your attention on what expands your freedom. You have to do it. You have to do it. So I make all these videos available and do everything I'm doing is to try to help others put their attention on freedom. So, you know, I'd love for more people to be doing this. But you can't be lazy. So I'm always working at it. You got to work at it. But it's worth it. Because ultimately, what Nisargadatta Maharaj said this morning was that he said there are those who their enlightenment, their liberation creeps up gradually, almost imperceptibly. And he says they don't even know it really. And it needs to be pointed out to them. But he says, interestingly enough, these tend to be the ones that are most reliable. Their enlightenment is most reliable. He says there's nothing spectacular. It creeps or just creeps up on them. And I was like, wow. It just hit home so hard. And this is the experience I've had in my life. You hear these spectacular examples of somebody, you know, that just they're light and boom. And like, wow, how come that can't have, you know, doesn't take place in my life? And how come I have to just constantly work at it? And here's Maharaj saying, though, he says, that's actually, when it goes that way, this is the most reliable. It's the best, most reliable. It's like, wow. And like Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodo, the Dharma King, he's so unknown and so unspectacular and just so, and yet he feels so reliable. It's just, so somehow you get this 360 degreeness going. And when you get there, you really stay there and you keep expanding and you keep being more and more helpful. It's the path of the Dharma Kings, really. It's not like you're doing some breathing exercise, you know, for 10 years in breathing and suddenly, boom, you know, have this enlightenment experience or something. No, this is more 360 degree of just feeling the overall context of our whole continuity fear dance. It's really a dance of continuity fear. And taking the long-term picture of what's really going to work for everybody. And how is it we're able to get past it? It's just an overall overview, an immersion in the entire compassionate effort of God's plan to liberate us from our dance of continuity fear, really, and shift from honoring our creativity in the lowest possible way to honoring our creativity in a medium way. This is God's plan for our salvation, actually. So I've been immersed in this for my whole life, 60 years, immersed in it all. Living it, I've lived it. This is my whole life, that's all I've ever lived. It is constantly trying to see what is most helpful and how can we move in this direction and just been a workaholic at it. But there's nothing really spectacular. Well, every day's spectacular. I guess the spectacular is the norm now. But for me, it just seems like it's just gradually creeping up on me. You like that? There's nothing, there's no like. But apparently, this is, Maharaj says, this is the best. This is the best. This way. It turns out to be very reliable, which is what we want. Some have these enlightenment experiences, and then a year later they've lost it, or the wheels come off. You know, they become, you know, the super confidence, which is part of it all, which is fine. It's fine to be a world beater, super confident world beater. This, but some it slips somehow, and they go off the track, off track, and it turns out to be not as reliable as you would have hoped it to be. So what we're looking for here is something that's reliable going forward. Nothing wrong with being super confident, super positive. Yeah, that's great. And being a cheerleader for it all, and adamant, all super adamant. Maharaj is super adamant. Okay, absolutely. But reliability is also a factor. Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro, he is so grounded in such a 360 degree approach, where he is a master of all approaches of Tibetan Buddhism. Every school of the eight paths of Tibetan Buddhism that are practice lineages, every single one of them considered him a master in their own lineage. This is how well-rounded he is. So there's this feeling of reliability with him. This is a feeling I get. It's like this is someone who's not going to go off the reservation, wander off the reservation. This is the feeling I get, is trustworthiness, commitment, trustworthiness, long-term trustworthiness. Since I'm on a path of long-term commitment, I don't know what else to do with myself, you know, except that I want someone who is long-term trustworthy. Okay. I don't want just some flashy guru, which I admire, you know, those who are real cheerleader-ish and stuff. Yeah, I love that. I mean, I love the fieriness and all that stuff. But also, I want someone who I feel is going to be long-term trustworthy. Long-term commitment. So then I can really get into that myself. You see, be part of that. That's what I'm looking for. And Longchenpa and Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro and Jesus Christ, for example, have that. I feel that they're committed to working for the liberation of all of us until the very last one of us is liberated, and they have a plan. There's a plan. They're following the plan. They're committed to it. So this is very compelling. It's not fast food spirituality here. So this is what I'm attracted to. I get boosts from some other gurus. I get boosts from them. But the Dharma kings, you get this feeling that they're in it all the way, and they're very reliable. There's not some stray complex that's something going to pop up and come. They would become megalomaniacs, you know, spiritual megalomaniacs or something. There's not some instability there. You just feel like they're just completely grounded and smoothed out. Trustworthiness, long-term trustworthiness. So that's what I'm attracted to. Now, of course, there's always the perfunctory ego show of uncertainty and distrust, and, oh, I don't know if I can trust you. That's just perfunctory. You just have to act that way in this world, because otherwise people think that you've gone crazy, because nobody can be trusted that much. What are you talking about? Long term, like that's nuts. I always tell them, D disregard the perfunctory, ego chatter, reaction. It's just, I'm just doing that to stay in shape, in terms of, so I can fake being an idiot here in the world, which we have to fake being insane, basically. You come here, born, and maybe somewhat sane, in a sane condition, as I was. And then you realize everybody here is insane. And so you got to learn how to fake insanity. And I was very bad at that. I had an extremely difficult time. Ultimately, I had to get super depressed or super exhausted, just so I didn't have any energy to express myself at all. I really subverted my energy here just so I couldn't express anything. And that's the only way I could function here, was just no expression, because I was too tired. I was so exhausted. I could just sit in a chair. I couldn't even talk. I was too tired to even talk. I could hold a book and read. And that's about it. Because what I had to say, nobody wanted to hear, then they hated it. And I get in so much trouble if I said what I wanted to say. So I just made myself so exhausted I couldn't even talk. And that was the only way I felt I could be here in this world. Isn't that a sad, condemnatory perspective, a revealment of this world, that you feel you can't even, you have to be super sick to even be here, so you can't function at all. Otherwise, people would, hate you. Now, I certainly had some bad habits from previous lifetimes, which I didn't want those to be expressed also. Habits that are not acceptable. You get habits from different lifetimes, which were acceptable in those lifetimes, but when you come to a different era, a different time, then it's no longer acceptable. Like if you were had the habit of freedom, great freedom, and you're born in communist China, you wouldn't fit in at all. And people would say you have terrible habits. Terrible habits. Or vice versa. If you're used to living in a despotic culture, you're born into the United States, people say you got terrible habits. What are you trying to do? You don't fit. So it's overall consolation, but I certainly was very outspoken as a child, extremely outspoken. In fact, people just thought I was, too much in terms of correcting anyone here who had a misperspective, spiritual misperspective. I mean, the perspective, spiritual perspectives were flawed, badly flawed. As a child, I would just speak up and say, "No, that's not right. This is the way it is." And the people here just said that what you can't do that. What do you mean? God didn't make the world and people and bodies and what do you mean? No, God created the flesh, put us here. They just so they wouldn't go along. They wouldn't put up with that. And so I felt very much ostracized and put down. And finally, and just to get along, I just, went into a sickness mode, just to get along. I subverted my own energy, my own presence here, because my self-expression was not allowed here. This is the tragedy of this world. It's very true. What a tragic commentary on this world. So I don't want to go through that again. And the way that the geopolitics is going is, I feel I can't be in this world and express myself here at all. I mean, the political correctness is so terrible. So many people just hate it. This tragedy with my cousin, and if you feel free to pray for her. Ask prayers for her that send all your spiritual protectors to help out. Why not? Why not pray for someone who's had a terrible accident? And she's breathing on her own, but again, that doesn't the internal bleeding in the head and swelling has seemed to stop and seems to be abating, but you don't know what damage has been done to the brain. And the fact that you're breathing in itself is doesn't mean that much. I mean, there are plenty of people. I know someone that works in a coma hospital, where the whole hospital, it's up in Oakland, the whole hospital is full of people simply living in comas, a coma state, and they're all, most of them are breathing. Most of them are breathing. You have people on IVs that just permanently IV. There been, he said there have been people there for 30 years on IVs, keep, because people don't want to take them off life support IVs, but they breathe on their own. So just because you're breathing doesn't mean you're not in a coma, you know. So but so the first cousin, one of my only cousins, relatives, is in this situation right now. So, I'm really praying. I'm sending all the Dharma kings to help her out. And I know that Longchenpa, and Jamyang Khyentse Choekyi Lodro are responsive to this. And will do everything they can do to help out. There's karma involved, of course, which means just a dance of continuity fear. Karma is just a dance of continuity fear, actually. It's a much better way of looking at it, because this is an operational way of looking at it. There's room to operate with this, because we can evaporate our continuity fear, which is what we do when we place our attention on those who have dropped all concepts. We are actually evaporating our continuity fear. So again, I highly advise to boycott anything that which isn't putting your attention on those who have dropped all concepts. This is a better way, easy way of putting it. I say boycott what anything and everything which is not putting your full attention on those who have dropped all concepts. The Dharma kings have dropped all concepts, including the concept of liberation, salvation, enlightenment. They've also dropped that concept. So again, what boycott anything and everything which isn't those, and put your full attention on just those who have dropped all concepts. Nothing else. Boycott everything else. Put your full attention on those who have dropped all concepts. Boycott everything else, so to speak. And my own role as an encourager of this, is an encourager of this. Now, we also interact, the Sangha, there's interaction with that. Some, pragmatically, of course we understand that. But by and large, put your full attention on those who have dropped all concepts at this point. It's super important. This world is a concept. Bodies are concepts. Thoughts are concepts. Thinking are just concepts. I've explained what concepts really are, but it's a little tricky. It's really the dance of continuity fear. It's really pursuit of what we already are. It's a tunis. It's a pursuer is a tunis. Is it right? There's the pursuer and that which is being pursued, right? We're already where we are, what we are, as we are. There's nothing to pursue at all. So there's no two-ness. We're not a pursuer of what we are. Isness is not pursuing isness. Everything is. There's no pursuit of isness at all. Even the so-called pursuit of isness just is. So there are no concepts in reality at all. There's no two-ness at all. There's just oneness. So we have to keep putting our attention on this, because geopolitically coming up, trouble is coming. And when we say trouble, we mean severe trouble. Too much trouble. Let's put it this way. It's in the category of too much trouble. put your attention on those who dropped out concepts. Don't put your attention on the yoga girls, okay? They expect you to. They're desperate for you because they want you to see them as awesome. That your awesomeness, you're being knocked out by them and their awesomeness, you can't live without it. And then what happens is then they exploit you. And they say, well, I'm going to take away the awesomeness out of your life if you don't protect me and work for me and provide creature comforts for me and enslave yourself for me. This is what happens here. So you never want to see awesomeness in any yoga girl. And they're absolutely working it to appear awesome to you. Now, I say that every day you've got to be knocked out. But be knocked out by those who have dropped all concepts. They're trustworthy. They're safe. They will not exploit you. Okay? They don't need your protection. They don't need you to protect them. They're absolutely free and completely safe. They know that nothing can happen to them lest it be their own choosing. They will not exploit you. Jamie and Kenzie Choki Lodra will not exploit me. This is my feeling. The ego says, oh, yeah, you got to be careful. That's perfunctory stuff. And my feeling is, I know he won't, but the ego always jumps up and says, well, yeah, how can you be sure? I say, that's perfunctory stuff. That's just like, acting like an idiot. Okay. All right, so don't react to that stuff. Doubts always jump up at some point. Always. It's perfunctory, okay? Don't even respond to it or act to it. Just say it's perfunctory stuff. Just let it subside. But it happens to all of us because we're so used. The ego says you can't trust anything. You can't trust God. Yes, God's running for you. You can't even find God. You're pursuing God, but you can't get a hold of it. How can you trust it? No. Drop all pursuit, even of non-pursuit. Drop the pursuit of non-pursuit also, and just be. Just abide in the isness, awareness of the isness, the vision of oneness. So, the yoga girls, and this happens when there's strife coming. Women, because they produce the next generation, okay, of bodies of sensory perception devices, which are blindfolds, spiritual blindfolds, produce the next generation of spiritual blindfolds. They understand very clearly that they need to be protected and survive physically so they can have children and care for the children. And they see that the male's role is protecting them. That's it. And they have very sensitive antenna. And they're aware more clearly than men are of troubles that are coming. And you can tell by their actions and reactions and what they're doing is, how much trouble is coming. Are they slacking off and taking it easy and not really trying to seem to be so awesome to men? Or are they just absolutely hammering their efforts to appear to be awesome? To present themselves to men in a certain way that the men think, oh my gosh, you're so awesome, just by everything, and I can't live without you, that kind of thing. I have a know someone well who their relatives, there's a situation where there was this man and his wife died. Well, they were both young, and he couldn't live without her, and he basically drank himself, that committed suicide, because she was his everything, so she was his awesomeness. This is terrible, but this is what happens, is the women feel, when there's something really drastic coming, they say, we have to survive to produce the next generation of blindfolds. So we need the men to protect us and sacrifice themselves in our protection. And so we got to hook them on the drug of awesomeness, that we're so awesome they can't live without us. So that then we can then use that leverage to get them to protect us. And throughout history, they've done just that. Just that. And so history is simply repeating itself. The women are aware there's severe threat to their survival coming up. And they are absolutely full on working to present themselves in such a way as to hook the men into feeling that they're just knockout awesome. They can't live without them. And it's a drug. It's just like the drug pushers hook you on drugs and then say, guess what? Yeah, I'm having trouble getting that drug for you right now, but I got kind of a problem. But you can help me with that problem. If you can help take care of this problem, I can get the drugs for you again. And the drug addicts will do anything. They'll do anything. This is why drug addicts are criminals, because the drug pushers are very sly, and they'll say, "I need you to go in and break into this house, steal all this stuff, get the, whatever, do whatever, whatever, assassinate this person or do this, whatever they want." And the drug people will do it because they need the drugs. They'll do it. This is why drugs are so terrible. Is it those who are controlling the flow of drugs? They're greedy and they want power and influence. They want everything to be the way they want, and they have these drug addicts commit criminal actions for them, and they're controlling that. Well, the women control men in much the same way drug pushers control the drug addicts, is they want to get men feeling the men cannot live without them, that because this is the source of the awesomeness that men are feeling that makes their lives worthwhile. And then they start saying, well, gee, I just don't I just don't feel so awesome towards you anymore. I mean, but I got this problem. So, and the men feel that the awesomeness is like being, like withdrawn from them. And then they say, but if you take care of this problem for me, the awesomeness will be back. And so the men will do anything for them, anything, including sacrifice their lives. And this is what the women want. They want men to sacrifice their lives for them so that the next generation of spiritual blindfolds can be produced. And the body is just a sensory apparatus. It's completely neutral. It's just a sensory apparatus, which is designed to blind us to spiritual reality. This whole matrix of this world, existence, as we call it, existence, bodies, flesh, world, forms, we call it life forms, they're really blindfolds. Different forms of blindfold, all these blindfolds here, blindfolding us to spiritual reality, pretending to be ignorant of it. That's all that it is. There's no need to perpetuate. You ask, does the human race have some great destiny? No. Does human body, flesh, have some great destiny? Not at all. We will ultimately, everyone see that we don't need it at all. These are this is just how we try to blind ourselves to spiritual reality. We're spirit. Okay, we're spirit. 100%. As Jesus says, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And so, of course, Jesus said this world will pass away. We won't keep this world. This world's designed to blind us to spiritual reality. And we won't keep bodies. We won't keep this world. We won't keep the human race. None of that. We'll all pass away. We'll just say, oh, that was silly. That was really silly. And that's it. It's just the dance of continuity fear right now. The only thing that's keeping it all in place is the dance of continuity fear. That's it. The idea that God, created the world and created humans is ridiculous. Completely, we're just doing that to reassure ourselves that it won't vanish, because it frightens us. But it's really just our own continuity fear that is projecting all this. We're projecting it, mentally projecting it. God is not doing that. God is absolute freedom. God doesn't say you have to experience a world or bodies or anything like that. No. Now, God may be creating, co-creating decorations, I don't know exactly, but certainly God did not create this world or bodies or death or sickness or any of this, actually. This is our own imagination manifesting this. The absolute is beyond being and non-being, actually, or decoration and non-decoration, you might call it. Right? This is just decoration, ornamentation of intrinsic spaciousness. The true, the God, the Absolute, is beyond manifestation and non-manifestation, meaning whatever manifests or doesn't manifest doesn't change the Absolute at all. The Absolute remains the Absolute. And that absoluteness permeates both the manifest and the unmanifest, which are just decorations, ornamentation of pure spaciousness. So, for example, I'm doing my workouts, and I usually don't do them in public, but I've been doing a little bit of it in public, because there's so many yoga girls. I mean, they dominate, and you know, they'll go around looking at you like, "Do you think I'm awesome? Do you think I'm awesome?" I mean, they walk around, they're constantly like, you can see that are you looking at me? You think I'm awesome? You think I'm awesome? This is how it is. It's a funny thing that people, the feminists say, "Oh, we don't like men looking at us." But the fact is, they walk around. How do they know we're looking at them? Because they're always aware who's looking at me, who's looking at me, and what they really want is how awesome am I? Am I awesome enough? Am I awesome enough that I can get someone to throw away their life for me? You know, protect me and take care of me and protect me. But again, this is understandable within the context of producing bodies, spiritual blindfolds. But we don't really need to keep producing bodies or spiritual blindfolds at all. This is not a mandate from God in the slightest bit. This is just simply a dance of continuity fear. So they say, can I keep the dance of continuity fear going? Do people think I'm awesome? How awesome do people think I am? And so what I do, I don't even look at them at all. I don't pay, like jogging on a path, here comes a yoga girl. And they're just, you know, absolutely sleeked out. And they're trying to appear as awesome as possible. But, you know, you're jogging, you see, here comes a yoga girl. So you just get a quick glimpse of, and you could tell, you know, is this someone who's saying, I want feedback from you on how awesome I am. And so I just go, and I don't pay any attention, like I have blinders on. I don't even... nothing. And you could tell this like kind of shocks them. They don't like that at all. They want you. They want feedback on how awesome they are. Because they want to know what to work on. Okay, he thinks I'm awesome, but there might be still some, I can be a little more awesome, you know. Okay, so what part of me is so awesome, and how can I, you know, act? They want this constant feedback. Well, guess what? I have better things to do than give constant feedback to yoga girls, okay? Really? So it's such a pain that you go out and I'm using this term yoga girls because it's actually quite descriptive, but it's the same way all over the world. Whether, you know, it doesn't mean they're doing yoga, but a lot of them are, because they're trying to improve their awesomeness. But it's the same way everywhere, is, and always has been. You know, you get a lady in Victorian times with her parasol and her her bustles and you know, all the way they dressed in corsets and hat with feathers and, you know, strolling down the avenue in Paris and so demure, you know, with her little bee sting lips and all dressed up with their cuffs and so, and, you know, covering up all the flesh, but of course in all this finery clothes and walking in a certain dainty way and graceful way. You don't think that she's looking to see what the reactions are of how awesome she is? Of course she is. Super aware. This is what I've noticed. Women are super, their awareness is caught up in constant, like, radar of what reactions are to people of how awesome they are. And they're very psychic about it, too. They're like consumed. Their attention is consumed by 360-degree awareness of feedback from their environment of how awesome they are. And Are they showing too much flesh, or who's seeing that? It could just be, you know, back in Victorian times, they might have show too much of their wrist, but if they want to test out their awesomeness, they might show a little more wrist. And if a dandy, you know, someone they want to say, oh, here's a sucker, he would sacrifice his life for me, they let them see a little bit of that wrist and then check the reaction. But if there's somebody who they don't like or don't want, you know, don't think they would, they'll immediately adjust the cuff on their wrist so they, you know, it's not being shown, even like a millimeter of flesh. I've noticed that they're aware of exactly how much flesh is showing, and they adjust it to the millimeter depending on, you know, how the what kind of reactions they're getting and who they want to react. And it's like psychic. You know, you can even be behind them, they're aware of it. You know, it's just amazing that their attention is so consumed by this radar feedback of how awesome am I? What's my awesomeness quotient? And how can I up it here? And they're constantly adjusting and working on it, constantly. And guess what? I have something better to do than pay attention to that now. I want to observe, and I see what's going on. Wow, but now I see what it is. And they just expect, for instance, men to sacrifice their lives for them, for their quote-unquote children. But we say, hey, wait a minute. We don't need to preserve the human race at all. I don't feel any need to preserve the human race. The body's nothing but a spiritual blindfold. God did not create the body at all. The body is nothing but our dance of continuity fear. That's all that it is. There's zero value, as Jesus says. The body has no value whatsoever, except as a communication device to spread the good news. The body has no value. The world has no value. Jesus says the world has zero value. It says the world tells you absolutely nothing about what you are. Zero value. No value. This is Jesus Christ speaking. So how could God create the world if Jesus Christ says the world has absolutely no value? God did not create this world. He says, drop your value of this world entirely. Doesn't sound like somebody who's trying to keep the human race going as if the human race has some glorious destiny in this world. We're supposed to be caretakers of this planet, and you know, and the human flesh is the, you know, we can make it awesome. No, they don't. That's not someone who believes in that at all. So, again, nothing can happen to you that you don't want to happen to you. Women don't really need protectors. Nothing can happen to them unless it's our choice. They've always managed to survive under all circumstances and still have children, if that's what they want to do. But the protector thing is they basically want to feel that they're able to control somebody. And it's continuity fear. It's continuity fear. It's not trusting their own freedom. Dance of codependency, dance of continuity fear. A lot of issues, but the bottom line is don't pay attention at all. And it freaks them out. Don't pay any attention. Give them no attention to how anyone looks, actually. But especially the yoga girls. They're the princesses who believe that you were born to serve them. Okay, you were born to serve them. And some of them even blabbed it publicly, explicitly saying the whole God created men for the express purpose simply to serve women. That's it. And that the only way that men can be happy is through worshiping and serving women. I won't name a name. I don't want to put her on the spot because at some point she'll realize, you know, just this was just a dance of her continuity fear. But someone very prominent feminist has literally said this in a video. I just like my jaw dropped. But we thank her for her directness in saying this. That God created. She said God created men specifically to worship and adore and serve women. And the only way men can ever find happiness is through this. There's no other way. Wow. This is the yoga girl belief. Deep down, this is their belief. And I want to make it very clear that the yoga girls, those who are spiritualizing concepts, they have a lot of spiritual power in the world right now. Tremendous political power. Feminists have basically are ruling the world. They're doing the reptilian work for the reptilians here, helping subvert our spiritual will here. And of course, they're getting us, instead of putting our faith in the Dharma kings, their awesomeness, which is leads us to true liberation and freedom, they're getting us putting our faith in their physical awesomeness. So that subverts our spirituality, spiritual will. And this is what's exactly what the reptilians want. So basically, the yoga girls are subverting this world spiritually so that the reptilians can take it over. And then we'll see that, oh, we need, you know, their awesomeness. We need to serve their awesomeness. So we'll go from serving the yoga girls' awesomeness to now serving the reptilians' awesomeness. And this is our destiny. We think this is our destiny. And they just want to produce slave race. You know, we'll be producing slaves for them. This is their plan. They don't want us to say, hey, gee, I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I don't need to create any slaves for you at all. They want us to create slaves, keep propagating slaves. Be fruitful and multiply is really propagate these slaves, these spiritual blind, spiritually blind slaves to serve the reptilians every whim. So do not put your attention on those who have dropped all concepts. They are not going to subvert you. They're not going to enslave you. They're not going to exploit you. They're not working for the reptilians. Okay? Not at all. Christianity, Tibetan Buddhism, they have a history of driving out the reptilian influence from this planet. You know, the history of Christianity is that of getting rid of these dragons, these serpents. It means the reptilian influence on this planet. They did a tremendous job in pushing the reptilian influence off of this planet, away from this planet. Reptilians have been trying to make this planet their own for a long time. So there's been a battle, a war going on, spiritual war, of who controls this planet. What are the influences here? And the reptilians want to control this planet, and it's to help their expansion to other areas and planets, and to exploit it, of course. That's what they do. So this battle has been going on for a long time. The Tibetans and Christians are very, very expert at preventing the takeover from happening and driving them away. Padmasambhava drove the reptilian influence out of Tibet. A lot of it freed it up. And they continue to do that. And but now they've subverted Christianity to such a point where the political correctness is stifling everybody. It's a hideous prison we live in, political correctness, isn't it? It's so terrible now. It's just, you can't even say, well, can you pray for my cousin? Nobody can say pray. I mean, what is the matter with these people? Truly, I mean, have they gone insane? You can't turn to God for help? No. The political correctness in its essence is saying you cannot turn to God for help. It's not allowed. It's incorrect. Wow. And they're leading us right into the jaws of the reptilians. Reptilians being this cosmic race that is able to has expanded, has many, many different planets and different star systems, who has been able to expand themselves cosmically. They're able to travel, you know, interdimensionally, and you know, they have ways of going to these different places, and they colonize. It's how this universe works in many ways, and the reptilians are a force cosmically to be reckoned with. They have their hierarchy, they have their, you know, power structures, they have their civilizations, they think very highly of themselves. They've been around a long, long time, ancient, 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 in terms of their dance of continuity fear has been, the dance of continuity fear has been dancing in a reptilian way for a long time. It's the dance of arrogance. It really is. And here on this planet, we want to evaporate our continuity fear. So here it's a dance of grace. We've wanted, that's why Jesus Christ came here, for a dance of grace on this planet, to evaporate our continuity fear. So we leave the dance of arrogance behind. The reptilians are those who are very much enmeshed in a dance of arrogance, which is strong continuity fear. They're very arrogant, which is why the Chinese think nothing of going into a store where there's all these patrons there waiting in line patiently, and everyone, they'll just walk in and walk up to the counter and expect to be helped, completely bypassing all the people in the store was prior to them, like they don't even exist. That's a reptilian attitude. This is the way the reptilians are. They're so arrogant that you don't count matter to them at all. You're just there as a slave to serve them. Like, and so they'll just walk up just at the front of the line. This is a long line. Well, this happened to us to me yesterday. It was amazing what happened. I was trying to go downtown, and it's gridlock. I said, This is insane. It was so bad that when a traffic light turned green, only one car was able to get into to turn. I had to turn onto this road. One car per traffic light cycle. That's how bad it was. It took me a half an hour to get from where I am to downtown. several miles, half an hour, virtually almost, and. So we are in this line of traffic on the street, and it is just hellacious. Nobody's moving. It is gridlocked, and people are saying, "Wow!" And it's hot. It was like 98 degrees here yesterday. And you can tell people are not happy. Nobody's happy. And I was supposed to pick someone up. I said, "Wow!" I called. I said, "Look," I said, "I'm not moving at all. I'm not going anywhere. I'm completely stuck in traffic." I would say, "Good Lord, we're not used to this. This is crazy." So I was looking behind me, and there was this car behind me, and there was this like left turn lane. The dash double yellow lines where it's kind of you can get into it, and you can turn from that. Going left. So I see he pulls out of traffic and gets into this double yellow median area, which then leads up to a turn for some street way up there. He has his turn signal on, and so he zooms along this unoccupied median area, double yellow median area, all the way up to where you can turn left. And I figured, well, he snapped. He's gonna go some alternative route, go the back roads or something or whatever. I said, okay, good for him. He just can't take it anymore. So he bypasses, all this traffic. I don't know how many cars, 20, 30 cars or something, with a left turn signal. And what does he do? He gets up to the furthest most point where you have to turn now. There's no more, turn area. And suddenly he just jams his way in to the line of traffic, and it goes right and pushes his way in to the gridlock traffic there. It was a guy and a gal in a car. I say he, but you can bet that his significant other or wife is saying, freaking out, like, "Hey, come on, can't you do something, guy? Can't you do something, guy? Aren't I awesome enough for you to do something for me?" And the guy says, "Of course you're awesome. Well, you're unbelievably awesome. I want to watch this. I'm so inspired by your awesomeness. I'm going to gain 30 car lengths and save us, 10 minutes or something." She goes, "Oh, there's my guy." This is how it goes. I'm just telling you the truth about it all. Guys try to show women how awesome they are and by showing off. Like I said, I'll do this for you, whatever it takes, to keep your awesomeness in my life. You want me to do this? Sure, I'll do that for you. Because they're afraid that of the losing that quote unquote awesomeness. And the women always let them know, hey, I could, you could lose it. You could lose it. So this guy driving the car did this. And it was so rude and so uncivil. I said, yeah, that's something the Chinese would do. What are you doing? You're not Chinese. What do you think? So all the rest of us stuck in traffic don't count. And you're so arrogant that you can just blatantly drive past all of us as if you're turning left, deceiving us all, and then just jam your way in. That was as, you can't get any more arrogant than that. I mean, that just displayed arrogance to an extraordinary extent. And I was dumbfounded because the rest of us, everybody else is playing by the rules and they're all upset and uptight. And this guy and gal somehow think that they don't have to play by the rules and they're better than all of us. Wow. That's when you know that things are getting real bad, when you see something like that. You see something like that every day now here, but in my own town, it under those circumstances, that's as bad as it gets. Now, I did see something the day before. Well, there was this left turn lane. It was backed up, really backed up, and the traffic was flowing, but the left turn lane was all backed up with cars, and so this car just decided to go in the through traffic lanes, bypassed all the backup in the left traffic lane, and then ended up turning left anyway. Through the traffic was coming. I've never seen anyone do that in my life. It was just. And that was Chinese. It's like, whoa. Wow. Making up their own rules of how, of just, you're all slaves and I can do whatever I want to. And you can't say a thing about it. See, slaves can't say anything to their masters of what the masters do. You can't say anything about it. You have no say whatsoever. We know this from slavery. Here around the world, of course, slavery has always been around the whole history of the world, and of course, in recent times we had it in the United States, so we're acutely aware of that, and we're always reminded of it. It's a good reminder. So we're very much aware of slavery, acutely aware of it, and the enslaved can't say anything. And this is the attitude here. It's like these people must think that we're so politically enslaved by political correctness, we can't say anything. And of course, nobody did anything. Nobody honked their horn or did, because it's not politically correct to do that. So political correctness is really enslaving us. We're turning us into slaves here. I hate it, political correctness. It's enslaving me. It's enslaving us. Plain and simple, because these people can do these things and you feel you can't say anything, you can't admonish them, and so this invites the reptilians into this planet. Political correctness invites reptilians into this planet. They hate freedom of speech, freedom of expression. It freaks them out. They have this whole chain of hierarchy of, and it's all what you can say. The Asians are very much this way in terms of, you don't dare say this to, I remember I lived in Japan, the Japanese are so super polite, you don't dare say anything. They know exactly what they can say to this person, but not to that person, and not to that person. There's a whole hierarchy of politeness, the chain of that. But in America, we don't have that. We can speak up and say, hey boss, I don't think you're treating me right. And boss, I'll respect you for speaking up. We respect freedom of expression more than we do obedience and slavery. See, we hate the idea of slavery in terms of the human spirit being enslaved, or our spirit being enslaved. Of course, we did have slaves here working the plantations as far as agricultural agrarian system goes, and indentured servitude, etc. like that. And we've gotten away from that. We understand that. But the principle is we support speaking up to authority. Speaking truth to authority is the American way. Speaking truth to authority. So, just ask yourself, you know, like candidates, can I speak truth to this authority? When they're in charge of my life and destiny, quote unquote, the bureaucracy, can I speak truth to the bureaucracy, their bureaucracy? Can I speak truth to it and not feel repercussions are going to come crashing down around my head? So this is a way to evaluate. Like for instance, Trump, I told a young person, I said, well, you know, yeah, any leader you have is going to do stuff you don't like. Plain and simple, of course. But can you say to Trump, hey, you know, Donald, which I hate what you're doing. I think it sucks. I think it's wrong. And this is why I think it's wrong. I think you can do better in this. This is why I think you can do better. I think you're misguided in this way. You know, I'm telling you, you know, you're an idiot. Can you say it to him? I said, yeah. I feel perfectly comfortable saying that to him. I don't feel the fear of political correctness gripping me if I spoke up to Trump that way. But with Hillary Clinton, are you kidding? You think you could say that? No, you would fear for your life. You'd feel fear for imprisonment. You know, the dread of political correctness immediately feel. You can't say. But to Trump, I could say that. I don't feel threatened by it, you know, that. Because, you know what, in The Apprentice, I think I did see one instance, somehow I saw The Apprentice one time, I don't know how that happened, but I did. And I was struck by how it was, because he says, you're fired. And he says, this is why I'm firing you, because you know, I told, this is what your assignment was, and this is how you went about it, and you screwed up here, and you screwed up there, and you screwed up here. And you twisted things around, and you tried to take credit where you didn't, wasn't justified, et cetera, et cetera. It says, so you're fired. It says, what, do you have any comments about it? What's your take on this? You know, so he like gives them an opportunity to speak back, and they said, well, wait a minute. And then he said, no, wait a minute. I want to dispute this, because let me give my side. He says, okay. And so he said, you know, the people that worked under me, they tried to subvert me and take credit for what I was doing. And, you know, I had a tough time managing them. And so they fire back at Trump and say, look, this is what my perspective on really happened. And then Trump would say, okay, let's, and then he should turn to the people, is this what's happened? What, you know, and so he would give them a hearing to say, well, you know, to and then what happened was he said, okay, I've heard you. You push back to me. This is how you push back. You defended yourself. You did it in a vigorous way. You did it in an intelligent way. I heard what you said. I've evaluated. I'm going to give you another opportunity. You're not fired. And I said, wow. That's the American way. He's an American. He's tough, but he's an American. That's the American way. You're fired, but you have a right to defend yourself. I hear your defense. It's justifiable. You're reinstated. You're not fired. Now, go and do better. And how are we going to do a better job next time? That's the American way. Self-responsibility. Stand up for yourself. Speak up for yourself. People respect that. You know, that respect we had for one another, this is what's been subverted by, let's frankly, the liberals, which I call them communist agents. Actually, they really are. They're subverting our respect for one another, speaking up by through political correctness. You don't dare say that to them, or you don't dare say, oh, to put her in charge of all you. Well, you can't speak to her that way. You know, in other words, you're a slave. They just said, yeah, but the slaveholder's awesome. She says, awesome yoga girl. So, you know, she'll remove the awesomeness from your life if you don't do what she says. So, I know it's not bad. It's slaves like these bad, cruel men. No, we got this nice, sleek yoga girl being the overseer now of the plantation. And you should be happy because she's so awesome. But, of course, if you don't sacrifice your life for the plantation, she'll remove the awesomeness from you. And you don't want that, do you? Because then you won't even want to live. Your life will be meaningless. I say, no, I've got Jesus Christ in my life. My life will not be meaningless. Oh, well, it's not politically correct to say that you have Jesus Christ in your life anymore. I'm sorry to tell you that. No, can you say, hey, boss, I got Jesus Christ in my life. I don't need your awesomeness. So let's talk on an equal playing field here about, you know, how I'm treated and how you're treated, and let's come to an understanding of equal mutual respect here. You know, just because you're a bean counter doesn't make you give you more rights to self-expression and freedom than me, right? Yeah, bosses have to look out. You cannot suppress the freedom of expression. But now it's only the liberals have freedom of expression to express their ideas of how we should all be enslaved. And if you say, I don't like that, well, you don't have that freedom of expression. You're fired. So the people now, the liberals, they're so ashamed, they can't even listen to what's being said. The people say, hey, wait a minute. No. We have to respect one another, our self-expression, my disagreeing with you. You can't just fire me because you claim I'm politically incorrect. That's not the American way. It's not the American Constitution. They can't even engage in that level. All they can engage with is now gun control. That's the only, they go to one issue because they're so incapable of defending what they're about, you know, which is being subversive on a level playing field. They just try to avoid the entire thing and say, no, gotta have gun control. That's the only issue. Clinton's in gun control. I'm voting for, that's it. Don't look at anything else. Put blinders on. They can't look at anything else because they want to be slaves. They want to be enslaved. They're enslaving themselves. They can't handle freedom. Jesus Christ, oh, that's too much freedom. You know, it's continuity fear. That's all it is. They're lazy. They're materialists. They don't want to feel a desperation and get to work. So I know how much work it is. It's a lot of work, but it's honest work. And it's very interesting and compelling work. And it's work that leads to true abundance, true prosperity. As Ram Maharshi said, you'll never have on this planet the equality that you're seeking. It will never happen. It comes from a Dharma king, Ram Maharshi. It will never happen. Just like in the Soviet Union or China, did you have equality there? Heck no. You had slaves and you had the overseers. You had the bureaucrats, a privileged class, telling everybody else what they had to do. You don't have equality. You'll never have equality in this world. You only will have disparity and inequality in this planet. Ram Maharshi said that. Take it to the bank. The greatest thing about America is you could dispute with anybody and you wouldn't be afraid of them calling the police on you or, you know, causing severe repercussions for you or attacking you or anything. You can say, hey, buddy, you know, what are you doing? This. And they look at you and say, well, you know, you're an American citizen. You have a right to speak up and express your viewpoint to me. And I have a right to speak up also. And so we might have a heated discussion or something, but you would respect each other for your right to do this, and you would love the fact that this could happen in America, because you know the alternative is enslavement. This is gone now. This is virtually gone. They're trying to completely bury it, absolutely bury it. And Trump is just the figurehead for those people who don't want to lose their freedom. They want the right to not be choked by political correctness. So you can't express anything except just a thank you for being so awesome and enslaving me with your awesomeness. This is basically what the reptilians want. They want everyone on this planet to say, oh, thank you, reptilian overlords. Thank you for enslaving me to your awesomeness, because I can't live without your awesomeness. This is such a wonderful arrangement for me. I can't think of anything that I could possibly want more than this. Yeah, but what about Jesus Christ? What? I don't hear anything. That didn't happen. Oh, that didn't happen. Yeah, I mean, you see, the liberals, they're so nervous about something, because something like the thought might pop in their mind of Jesus Christ, and they have to say, oh, that didn't happen. So they have this very sort of sleek nervousness, a self-consciousness of like watching their mind, making sure that there can't be any thoughts like that pop up in my mind, because the reptilians are so are the are all awesomeness is comes from them. All awesomeness comes from their bureaucracy. I'm so happy to be enslaved by it. And but they're always self-conscious, just watching you, those, like their thoughts. I can't have this thought. What if a thought of Jesus Christ pops up into my mind? Oh my God, that's like the worst thing ever. They're completely terrified of this. Completely terrified. And they want a regime in this world that protects them from this terror, so that no truth can ever bubble up in their minds, ever. This is what they want. They think it would completely disrupt their life, their beingness, their world. The reptilian overlords would say, "What did you just have a thought of Jesus Christ? We feel that you might have had that." Of course, they say that anyway. They'll look at you just to intimidate you, because they know that that's what you're afraid of. Did you just have a thought of Jesus Christ? They say, "No, that didn't happen. That couldn't happen with me. I don't even know what you're talking about." And the reptilians nod and smile and say, okay, I got a good little subservient slave here. Whereas what we say is, thought of Jesus Christ popped up? No. You know why? Because I think of Jesus Christ 24/7. So how could a thought pop up? It's a continuum. It's a smooth continuity continuum. That's all I think about. So it's not even thoughts popping up. It's I'm immersed in Jesus Christ. How about you, reptilian? What about you? You're immersed in Jesus Christ? Well, actually, you don't know it, but you are. You already are. There's nowhere else to be. Meaning, pure spaciousness. Jesus Christ is a potent reminder of that. Okay? Yeah. Not only am I already immersed, you're already immersed in it too. You're just pretending not to be. So, guess what? You get to wake up also. Hallelujah. Do you think the reptilians want to hear that? That's called freedom of expression. That's called the United States of America. Freedom of religious expression, which is under the worst attack ever, under a massive, hideous attack. Could you go to work and say, how are you? He says, well, how am I? I'm immersed in Jesus Christ. That's how I am. Can you say that? Maybe I'm going to do that pretty soon. I will. I know somebody that would accept that and say thank you. I'd probably be fired for not reprimanding me, right? If the clerks at the store don't reprimand you, they'll be fired. Says, you can't say that. Says who? If they have a right to suppress your religion, don't you have a right to express it, right? So let's be honest about what's going on. Because the truth of our being is God, is pure spaciousness, the truth of our being. So they're saying that you can have no access to the truth of your being. What kind of freedom is that? But they call that as politically correct. And so it's insane. It's upside down and backwards here. Totally. It's just absolutely bizarre beyond. Nobody's expressing the truth of their being anymore here. They're too scared of the consequences. Because again, you could do it in a restaurant someplace, but if the people who work there don't reprimand you, they might get fired. So out of kindness towards them, you don't do it. So everybody's being too kind, you know, because they're protecting people's jobs. But this is appeasement, and this is how you lose your freedom. You should be able to say, well, they fired you for that? Well, lawsuit, you know. We'll have their business license pulled for being discriminatory towards freedom of religious expression. You can't be just discriminate and say what people can, how people can express their innermost beliefs publicly. I say, well, you can't express it publicly. So that means you can have no public life. How discriminatory is that? It's extremely discriminatory. You can wear a rainbow shirt to work, nothing wrong with that, but you can't wear a shirt with Jesus Christ to work. There's everything wrong with that. That's discrimination. And it's the worst kind of discrimination, because it's saying you cannot express the truth of your being. And the truth of everyone's being is actually God in immaculate, perfect, absolute freedom. And Jesus Christ, quote unquote, is the way to that. Meaning the vision of oneness is the way to that. The vision of Christ, the vision of oneness, the vision of sameness, the vision of honoring our creativity in a medium way, in a middle way, medium way, is the way towards the truth of our being. And there is no other way. So when Jesus Christ says, there is no other way, I am the truth and the light and the way to that, this is what he is saying. That this vision, spiritual vision, guru vision, is the only way. That the vision he showed us, that's the only way. You first you see the intrinsic spaciousness of everything equally present. It's the only way. So to say you cannot express the only way to liberate to freedom and happiness in this world is to say that you're condemned to unhappiness here. So political correctness is really saying you must be unhappy. This is literally what they're saying, is you must be unhappy. You must be miserable. Misery is what you were created for. Well, don't you think the overseers want to propagandize and convince the slaves that they were created to be miserable? Of course they do. They want to stamp out any belief that we are entitled to happiness. And so political correctness is exactly that they're saying, you must be miserable. So the liberals are saying, you must be miserable. And guess what? I'm tired of being miserable. I've had enough of being miserable. I want to skip down the trail. I don't want to plod along like a baton death march, you know. I don't want to be schlepping along like a slug. I don't want to be moving like a slug, like all these tech slugs. Everyone moves like a slug here. I want to dance down the road of my destiny. I want to dance my destiny. I don't want to slug my destiny. I don't want to be a miserable slug like they're all in training us to be. A miserable slug. It's funny. I picked up this piece of plywood Friday, and on the bottom of this plywood, totally covered with slugs. Wow, it was a whole slug colony. I never see anything like it. I said, what the heck am I going to do? So I got this another board, and I just kind of scraped them all off. It didn't hurt them. I actually used my hand on some of them. I didn't kill any of the slugs, but I scraped them all off this board. I found a way to do it, you know. I try not to harm anything. I was able to scrape them all off and get all the slugs off of this board. But there was like hundreds of them. It was amazing. Perfect analogy for this world now. A bunch of slugs. We're being told that we're slugs instead of spirit, freer than the wind, dancing a dance of glory in reality, as Jesus tells us. He says, we're so much freer than the wind, you can't even express how free we are. Our freedom is absolutely immaculately perfect. And we dance this awesome dance of freedom, which he says is so glorious, there's no way to even explain it. He says, this is what we all are. This is what Jesus sees as our destiny, is to dance this freedom. And this world here sees our destiny as to be believe that we're miserable slug. We're created as miserable slugs to be miserable slugs forever and serve our awesome overlords. And that's our only purpose in life. This is what this liberal agenda of the world is all about. Plain and simple. And many of us know this, but nobody will say it like this, really. There, well, some will. I mean, the Americans are the last people in the world speaking up, speaking truth. They're the last people in the world speaking truth, actually. The Tibetans also have the guts to speak truth. The grace and the guts to speak truth. Dalai Lama has been throughout his life, but you know they're working on him as much as possible. You know, but he does like drugs. I say, what about drugs? Don't you think? He says, no, drugs are poison, absolute poison, absolutely no to drugs. And people, liberals, are like, what? You know, we thought we could use this guy. The liberals really want to use the Dalai Lama. They've been working on him desperately to espouse their belief. You know, their beliefs, but they can't quite control them. They haven't quite yet. I don't know exactly what's going on now, but he tends to have a stray thought every now and then, like, hey, he just says compassion, compassion, compassion. The liberals say, okay, as long as you say compassion, that's okay. Don't go off script, you know, go out. And of course, compassion means good works. I mean, be a good little slave, a miserable slug, and do what the good works of the reptilian overlords tell us to do. That's what they believe compassion is. Yeah, we got to make equality here. Even though Ramana Maharshi tells us that it's impossible to have equality here, because the dance of continuity fear is arrogance, always is insecure and always wants more than others wants, and contract believe happiness comes from having more, better than someone else. So the world will always be this conflict. It's a place of conflict. There's no way around it. So this idea of compassion by let's just do good works and make everything equal, that's not what he's talking about. He means compassion to ourselves means to take the path of liberation. That's what he's talking about. But they're desperately trying to, you know, think that he's some super liberal, that he's going to help them out. They really want to co-opt the Tibetans. The liberals are desperate to co-opt them. Desperate. Here I am, the super conservative, you might call, but no, I mean, libertarian, conservative, libertarian, equalitarian, as far as spiritual equalitarian, freedom of speech, expression, you know, this free spirit that, you know, completely seeing through the whole liberal agenda. And who shows up and gives me the recognition? The Tibetans, Longchenpa, and then who embraces me? Jamyang Kenzi Chogyi Lodro. They're not rejecting me because they know I'm speaking up for the Dharma. Okay. I'm a Dharma prince. I mean, I speak up for the Dharma. I protect the Dharma. I advocate the Dharma. That all our attention should be on that. And what's the Dharma? But actually, freedom. Going towards absolute freedom, recognition we already are that. So they don't reject me because I speak up like this at all. Just the contrary, they love it. So the Tibetans don't love enslavement at all. They're not pro-reptilian at all. They're anti-reptilian. They're anti-enslavement. But the liberals have been desperately trying to co-opt them. Of course, you would think that's what the liberals would do, because the reptilian overlords say, hey, we're not so comfortable with the Dalai Lama saying this stuff. Could you, you know, we need you to, like, tone it down. Can you work on him and tone it down and get... And so there's this huge effort by liberals to co-opt the Tibetan message. But they haven't co-opted Longchenpa, and they haven't co-opted Jamyang either. I can tell you that. They haven't co-opted him at all. The fact that they show up and embrace me means they haven't co-opted them at all. The more I speak up, the more they like it. Tibetans are some of the greatest truth tellers that we've had over the last 50 years or 60 years in this world. Thank God for them standing up for the Dharma, or we would be crushed by this time. If it weren't for the Tibetans speaking up, I think this world would have been crushed a long time ago. Because they, you know, their whole attitude is designed to embrace your inner truth, that you're free, and show you where real happiness is. And so it's completely counter to the reptilian agenda. Totally counter to it. So again, all homage and praise to the Dharma Kings, and we focusing on Tibetans, all praise and thankfulness and gratitude to the Dharma, omniscient Dharma King Longchenpa, who has our backs, and all his associates that he pairs us up with. He pairs us with his associates who he knows would be most compatible with. If we have this ease and comfort zone. He paired me up with Jam Yang, so I feel this comfort zone. It reminds me of my uncle, one of the best people that I've ever met in my life, ever walked the face of this earth, my uncle. Such a kind and compassionate and reasonable and thoughtful, and holy cow, you talk about somebody who would never step on your self-expression, that was my uncle. You feel you could say anything to him and it's okay. And he never stopped being totally gracious and genteel and kind and helpful. He was helpful to everybody. Everyone who met him just loved him. So this Jam Yang's very much like my uncle. He's like that. You feel that you can never get on the wrong side of him. He didn't have a wrong side, basically. Well, my uncle did have a few issues. He was worked on. People worked on him, but you know, more than almost anyone I ever met, you feel like he doesn't have a, you know, he can't get on his bad side. He didn't really have a bad side, not really. No. If he did, it was well hidden. But Jam Yang, you feel there is no bad side. There's nothing hidden. He doesn't have a bad side. You can't get on any bad side. He doesn't have it. He's just going to be view you in the most kindly light always. You can do no wrong in his eyes. Sure, he would advise and correct gently, except but he has absolute faith in you. You can do no wrong. You're going to. He knows what you really are. Yeah, it's just like that. You can do no wrong. That's and he's not trying to appear to be awesome to you at all. He's not saying, look at my awesomeness or something. Not at all. Just the opposite. He says, I'm looking at your awesomeness. You're awesome to me. The Dharma Kings, they look at you and say, you know, you're awesome. They have different, slightly different styles of that. Longchenpa, it's everything is completely awesome. There's no differentiation at all. It's difficult to relate to that, except you just have to abide in that. But as far as relating to it in a pragmatic way, it's difficult. That's why he paired me up with Jam Yang. I feel, because you know he's been in the world here just recently, he certainly can relate to the struggles we're going through right now. We're under the same sort of pressure that Tibet was put under by the Chinese, and so he understands this. So you feel like, you know, someone that you can express, and he's not, you know, he's not going to judge you. He's going to still keep his kindly view towards you. He's not going to suddenly be all insulted or anything. You know, you don't feel like you can insult him at all. Very fortunate to be paired up with Jam Yang like this. Can't get on his bad side. Doesn't have a bad side. There's no insecurities. You can't suddenly, you know, oops, I said something politically incorrect. I upset his insecurity. He doesn't have any insecurities. What a feeling. Can you imagine someone being with someone where you don't have to worry about your what you say, political correctness at all. Zero concern. Where someone has no insecurities at all. How amazing is that, isn't it? It's like a breath of fresh air, like you've been choked. We're being choked here. We can't get oxygen, spiritual oxygen, and then to get the spiritual oxygen, wow. I highly recommend everyone to put their attention on the Dharma kings, those who have dropped all concepts, who have no spiritual insecurity whatsoever. They're not afraid of their own freedom. Therefore, they're not afraid of your freedom either. They're not afraid of your freedom because they know that your freedom can never impinge upon their freedom. And in the slightest bit, we're all perfectly free. So they're not afraid of your freedom. Imagine that, someone who's not afraid of your freedom. In fact, they want nothing more than you to have perfect freedom. And they're not threatened by that in the slightest bit. Those are the Dharma kings. Jesus Christ, Longchenpa, Ramaharshi, Nandamayama, Jamyang Kenzi Choki Lodro, Dharma kings who are not afraid of your perfect freedom. They want you to have that, and they want you to have it right now. And from their standpoint, you don't need to do a thing to earn it or to delay it at all. They want you to have it in fullness of perfect freedom this very instant without any precursors or subsequentness, just to abide in it and with no need to defend it or justify it to them in the slightest bit. They're not threatened at all by it. So hanging out by those who are not threatened by your freedom is the way to freedom. That's why Jesus Christ said what he said. I am the way. Hanging out with that which is not threatened by your freedom, they are not threatened by your freedom, is the way to freedom. And hanging out with those who are very threatened by your freedom is the way to enslavement. Ramaharshi is so wonderful. Everything he says is basically says, look, I'm not threatened by your freedom. I want you to experience your full freedom this very instant. And people keep asking him questions like, hey, surely, you know, you don't really, I mean, if I'm really free, it's going to bother you, right? He says, not at all, not at all. Just don't even worry about it. Just put all your attention on freedom right now. Forget about these issues. Put all your attention on freedom right now. This is Ramaharshi. All your attention on freedom right now. He never backs down. He's just absolutely fabulous. You read his responses to questions. It's just like you expect he's going to, you know, kind of equivocate. No, 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 no. Forget about the world. He said, the world's nothing. The world's nothing. It's just an attempt to enslave yourself. That's all it is. The body's nothing. He said, the body's nothing. Why give it any attention? The world's nothing. Why give it any attention? He said, it's not worth trying to pursue anything that's, he says, anything that's impermanent, it's not worth you pursuing it at all. At all. So he says, don't pay any attention to what's impermanent. What's permanent? Our freedom. That's what we are. We're freedom itself. So he's saying, put your full attention on your freedom because that's what you are. I don't care about bodies. I don't care about worlds. And you don't have to either. They don't impress me in the slightest bit. I don't value them in the slightest bit. Ramana Maharshi did not value bodies. He did not value worlds in the slightest bit. And yet he was supremely kind to everything. Because he saw it just as all decoration of intrinsic spaciousness. Super adamant. So freedom does not threaten Ramaharshi. He always directs us right back to our own freedom. The freedom which is. The freedom which is. The freedom which is. Always directs us right back to that. It's extraordinary. You keep thinking there's wiggle room. No, he's going to concede. No, he doesn't concede. Ramana never conceded. Ramaharshi never conceded his freedom and our freedom at all, under any circumstances. Never conceded it. You talk about someone that would go to the cross. Ramaharshi would go to the cross. There's no question about it. If someone said, we got to crucify you for your beliefs, He wouldn't change his beliefs in the slightest bit. He says, do whatever you want to with this body. It has nothing to do with me. This body has nothing to do with what I am. Would he defend himself and fight? No, he would not. When people attacked him when he was in meditation, he didn't do anything. He didn't even move. He said, do what you want with this body. It has nothing to do with me. I could care less. When cancer attacked the body, did he do anything? No. He said, let the cancer do whatever it wants with this body. This body is not what I am. It has no value whatsoever. Except you might say as a communication device. And I would say it does have value in terms of presenting the fact that it has no value. The presentation is important. So we don't want the gurus getting sick, you know, body dying. We don't want that, actually. I know that they're showing us that it doesn't matter to them. But I say, hey, you know, you've done enough of that. Jesus, you know, thank you. But we really need your presence here in many angles showing us that the body doesn't matter from many angles, not just through dying. Thank you for that. But let's have a 360-degree presentation of no valuing, except it's valuable as a communication device. So by all means, if the body gets sick, you know, bring it back to health. We could use you right here, Ram Maharshi, right now, I'll tell you that. They do that to dramatize the people who are really stuck, but when we're not so stuck, right, you don't really need the guru to die like that, the guru to die. You don't really need that. And Jesus says, in fact, he says, actually, when you accept the truth of your being, he says, the body will be perfectly well and will function flawlessly for as long as you want to function. He says, even if that could be a long, long time, indefinitely. He said, there's no cutoff point at all. As long as you want the body to be present and functioning, it will be perfectly healthy and perfectly functional. That's what Jesus says. You could live thousands of years flawlessly, hundreds of thousands, no difference. And the body would never be sick, never ill, and never cause you the slightest problem or concern, Jesus said. Literally. So they don't have to, you know, the body doesn't have to drop, but they do that to demonstrate that, yeah, what I was telling you, it really is the truth. The body is nothing. Put your attention on those who have dropped all concepts. Trust in them. Block out the world. Those who value the world and bodies and all that. Block it all out. Boycott it. Just put your attention on those who have dropped all concepts and nowhere else. Nowhere else. Nowhere else. And to the extent that the body can be used, people can use the fear of the loss of the body life to coerce us, intimidate us towards enslavement. To that extent, you know, we need help here because we still value the body somewhat. And right? I know Christianity is a tradition, is you don't value the body at all. That's why all the Christian martyrs, there have been hundreds, I mean, I don't know how many hundreds of millions of Christian martyrs throughout history. Really, I mean, extraordinary number. Is Jesus set the example, don't value the body at all. The early Christians rejoiced in being fed to the lions, having the body fed to the lions or crucified on a cross. They said, this glorifies our Lord even more, showing us to do not value the body. Body has no value. The world has no value. That's good witnessing. But for those who still have some valuing of it, you know, we also need witnessing through clarity and reasoning and clarity. It's different styles. I'm not really into being crucified, you know, not really. I don't want anything to be harmed. I don't want the body to be harmed. Why should I want the body to be harmed? I don't want to harm an ant. You know, I'm dragging something along the ground yesterday, and or day before yesterday, and there's a little sow bug. You know, I noticed a little sow bug crawling along the asphalt, and here I said, oh, you know, and I sidestepped it, right? I don't want to harm anything. Why should I want to? I don't want to harm a sow bug's body. Why should I want to harm this body? I don't want to harm this body. I don't want to harm an ant, or a fly, or a mosquito, or a yellow jacket, or anything. I don't feel like harming anything. So why would I feel like harming this body? I don't want the body to be sick. You know, it's just appearance, of course, but why even go down that road of giving the appearance of harm, you know, symbolizing harm, or death or something? Why? I've never liked any sort of harm or illness or injury or anything. It's always give me an abhorrence, you know, really.